Good morning, church. All right. How we doing? Yeah? That's a pretty good response. I'll take it. Well, as Dwayne had mentioned, Tim's been in this message series on vision. And vision takes on a lot of different forms. And we've been talking about what that looks like. We've been talking about what it means to have a vision for purpose. We've been talking about all of these different ways that we can use the vision that God has given to each and every one of us to make a difference in the lives of those around us. That's ultimately what this is about. Now, I have a lot that I want to try to get through this morning, and so I'm just going to dive right in. Is that okay? Yeah. All right. And this is a back and forth. This is a participatory type of message. So I'm going to ask you questions, and I expect answers. I don't expect to say, do you believe this, and then there be no response. So prepare yourselves, okay? Just prepare yourselves. There will be times where you have to respond. There's been a lot of talk lately in my circle about this thing that we just heard about in this video called legacy. But what really is it? What really is legacy? I think you and I probably have our own idea of what legacy is, but I'm not comfortable settling with my own idea. I want to know what God says about it. Because my ideas are human ideas. His ideas are God ideas. My ways are human ways. His ways are higher. His thoughts are higher. And if I'm not fixing my eyes on his ways, the higher ways, then I'm settling for something less. So I want to try to focus on what does the Bible tell us true legacy is. But before we see what the Bible says, I thought it'd be interesting to check the Webster Dictionary. The Webster Dictionary's first definition of legacy was financial. Someone receiving some sort of a financial inheritance as a legacy to take with them into their life from a loved one or someone that they received it from. But number two, this is the one we're going to be talking about today, defined as, quote, something transmitted by or received from an ancestor or predecessor or from the past. When I think of legacy, though, I don't always think about the past. I tend, personally, to think about the future. What kind of legacy am I going to be leaving for my children and for my grandchildren? For those who I encountered in my life, I think future tense. So which is it? Is it past or is it future? Well, I think after spending some time in the Word of God, I think the answer lies somewhere in the in-between, in the today. The right here, the right now. We just sang about that. The right now, your kingdom come, Lord. Not in the future, not in the past, but right now. I'll break that down in just a bit, but today matters. Speaking of today, I would be a terrible dad if I didn't mention that today is my oldest daughter Lily's 13th birthday. So, yes, it's actually today. I'm not making that up to make it be like a nice little sermon thing. But it is today. She turned 13 at 12:40 this morning. So when we all woke up, she was already a teenager. I told her I wouldn't embarrass her, so I'm not going to, but a proud dad can't keep quiet about his kids. And your father can't keep quiet about you either. And we're going to talk about his love for us today. There's actually more of a point to me bringing up Lily and her birthday. Naturally, becoming a teenager is a really big deal. So this weekend has been and will continue to be all about celebrating her. Except for the next 30 minutes. That time is reserved for the Lord. Yesterday, my wife, Kim, took Lily and a couple of her friends kayaking all morning while I stayed home with the other three and had the enviable job of laundry. Good times, right? Normally, laundry duty at best is something to just get through, right? Especially as a man. I don't like to be tied down to a laundry machine. I want to go do what I want to do. But yesterday there was something that made laundry a lot more difficult than normal. And in order to fully understand this story, y'all need a little bit of a backstory. You see, about 6 weeks ago, our washing machine, which was only about a month old, by the way, decided that it didn't want to work anymore. Like, just stop working. It went from efficiently and quickly, I might add, these new ones work really, really fast, to suddenly not washing any clothes. That's a problem. Did I mention I have four kids? So we began taking all of our clothes to a laundromat about once a week. Six people in a house require a lot of laundry. Not a big deal though, right? First world problem. We'll survive. After waiting 2 weeks for the warranty required company, because of course, Whirlpool only has one company in the entire Gulf Coast area that is considered worthy of warranty work. After waiting 2 weeks for them to come and check out my washing machine, we learned that, oh, it just needs a new part. Super easy, right? He'll just go back to the truck and get the part, or back to the warehouse and get the part, and we'll be up and running doing laundry in the comfort of our own home again, maybe tomorrow night. Yes. Not the case. Like everything else that you're trying to order, it's stuck in the Suez Canal or somewhere. He says, well, we have to order it. It's back ordered. It's going to be like 2 to 4 more weeks. And I'm like, okay, I have four kids, a lot of laundry, but okay, we'll survive. It'll be fine. So back to waiting and hitting the laundromat again. Well, I get the call just 2 days ago, this past Friday, that the part was in. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. But the company can't come out until the next available appointment, which is, drumroll, September 21st. I mean, really? Like, you would think that there'd be some sort of like a, I don't know, priority queue for people who've already been waiting for 4.5 weeks. Wait, or maybe it was 6. Yeah. No, September 21st. Yep, 3 more weeks. So like I said yesterday, while Kim and Lily and her friends were kayaking, I had the, now you understand why I use the word enviable job of laundry duty, but not just regular laundry duty, laundromat laundry duty. So I take off. About halfway there, I realize, of course, because, of course, I forgot all of the laundry detergent. Oh, well, not a big deal. Calm myself down, drive by Publix, pull in, get some laundry detergent. I'm on my way. When I get there, I realize something. I realize that Kim had taken my car to kayaking at Robinson Preserve. And guess what was in my car? My wallet. With any way for me to pay for said laundry at laundromat. But then I remembered, oh, wait, these people are like super smart and technological. They have an app. So I'll just log into the app that Kim's been using. Her credit card's already saved. Super easy, right? Y'all, this was yesterday, so it's still a little fresh. So if I get fired up, it's because it's still fresh. I don't know her password. I can't log in to her app. So I call her. She answers on her watch while she's out on the water kayaking, phone in the vehicle. I'm like, hey, do you know your password to the laundry app, laundromat app? Because I'm there and I need to do laundry. She's like, I think it's like this or that, this or that. And like, she gives me like 4 or 5 different options. Do any of those work? No, none of those work. We have no idea what the password is. So I think, okay, I'll just create my own account and then I'll pay that way. Maybe they take Apple Pay. No. You need, guess what you need? A credit card or a debit card, which was in the car at Robinson Preserve. So at this point, I did what any self-respecting man in a laundromat would do. I left. I quit, I gave up, and I left. I just go home. I gave up. I had to wait for Kim to come back with the girls, and then she and I together went back to the laundromat, because now I had the professional laundromat person with me to do the thing that we needed to do. What should have only taken a couple of hours ended up taking a large part of my Saturday, all because my washing machine decided that it did not want to work anymore. A simple thing caused a whole slew of problems in my life for a day. Now, I get it. Like, this is first world stuff. While most people are out enjoying the beach or doing their thing on Labor Day weekend, I'm at the laundromat. Like, and that's okay. That's, you know, hashtag dad life. But that's the way it is. And I was upset. But my washing machine had decided that it wasn't going to fulfill its purpose anymore. You see where this is going? We all have manufactured products in our home, whether it be a toaster, or refrigerator, or stove, microwave, washers, dryers, all commonly found in people's homes. But the thing is, they all have unique purposes. They've all been created and designed uniquely to do a different thing. Each one has its own unique reason for being. Now, if the appliance starts to operate outside of its reason for being there, then we have a problem, don't we? You don't try to cook things in your refrigerator or try to freeze things in your stove. You're going to have a problem if you try to do that, because that's not what the workmanship of the item is for. The appliance is used for whatever the creator has designed for it to do. The dryer can't just tell me, hey, Jeff, I'll just be a washer for you today. How about that? I know you need some help, so I'll just be a washer. It can't do that. As much as I would love for it to be able to do that, it can't. No, because it's a dryer, not a washer. We need both. It is the creator of the appliances that dictates to them the reason why they exist. The appliance does whatever it's designed to do, or it doesn't. It's as simple as that. And my washing machine for the past 6 weeks has done nothing. In the same way, you and I, we are created by God, and He dictates to us why we exist and can tell us what we are designed to do. The problem is, you and I decide that we want to break and do what we want to do, not what God tells us to do. We don't listen to what the Creator tells us we are designed for. We listen to what our feelings tell us we are designed for. So things break. We all do it. Just like a broken washing machine caused extra time, extra effort, extra financial cost to my life, when we don't live within the design God created for us, we encounter extra unnecessary difficulty. Now, don't hear me say that if you become a Christian or you're a follower of Jesus, that life will be easy. That is not what I'm saying. In fact, Jesus said it himself, "I promise you that you will have trouble." I'm talking about unnecessary trouble. The Lord doesn't give us any unnecessary trouble. But when we operate outside of what He's called us and designed for us to do, it's unnecessary trouble. There's a difference. When we walk in our purpose, we have a vision for legacy. What real legacy looks like, you're thinking, like, how is he going to make a washing machine story work for legacy? I'm not. God is. It's not about tomorrow, it's about today. Operating in and walking in our purposes today. Why? Because every day matters. Every single one. We live in today, but for tomorrow. If you have the notes, that's your very first fill in the blank. We live in today, but for tomorrow. All right, speaking of purpose, there's someone many of us have heard of, but usually not in a Sunday morning message. International superstar Justin Bieber has, yes, I am going to talk about Justin Bieber, has made the news a lot in the past, mostly for his poor decisions as a teen pop star, troubled teen pop star. But in 2015, Justin had an encounter with the living God. Did you know that? He turned his life over to Jesus. Is he perfect? No. Does he make mistakes? Yes. Are you and I perfect? No. Do we make mistakes? Yes. Well, Justin wrote a song that speaks to this, and just a few weeks ago, he actually performed this song in front of thousands of people at a gathering back in July. Now, I know this is unusual, but stick with me. Let's watch a few minutes of that performance together.
Feeling like I'm breathing my last breath. Feeling like I'm walking my last steps. Look at all of these tears I've wept. Look at all the promises that I've kept. Into your hands, learn the soul to keep. I let you in with all that I can. You're not hard to reach, and you bless me with the best gift that I've ever known. You give me purpose every day. You give me purpose. Thinking my journey's come to an end. Sending out a farewell to my friends. For inner peace, ask you to forgive me for my sins. Oh, would you please? I'm more than grateful for the time we've spent. My spirit's at ease. I put my all into your hands. Learn the lessons you teach. No matter when, wherever I am, you're not hard to reach. And you bless me with the best gift that I've ever known. You give me purpose. Yeah, you give it. God is in this room right now. I want you to put your hands up. God is here right now. He's in the midst of our pain and our struggle right now. I want you to put your hands up. You are not alone. Do you hear me? You are not alone. You are not alone. You are not alone. You are not alone.
Now, say what you want about Justin Bieber, but the man is publicly declaring the name of Jesus over millions of people these days. This song speaks to the gift that Justin had been given, and through that gift, he's now found purpose. You see, Justin lived for so long his own way, not God's way. And like an appliance trying to do what it wanted, not what the Creator told it to do, things were broken. Things were harder. But God gave Justin a gift. And now he understands something. That gift was to bring glory to God and not to himself. Church, when we begin operating in, walking in, living in the Spirit who defines our true purpose, that is when we begin to build true legacy. We talk about legacy as if it's some far-off future tense construct, but it's simply, listen, living today the way that God has designed you to live today. That's all it is. It's not hard. It's not some like thing we got to go to seminary for. Living with purpose and for legacy is simply living today the way that God has called you to live today. Don't worry about your past. Don't worry about the future. Jesus himself said it. Tomorrow's got enough problems of its own. Worry about today. One step at a time. One moment at a time. On purpose, in faith. Well, what is faith then? Is it just believing, or is it more? Faith is simply this: acting like God is telling the truth. That's all it is. I heard this a while back and I thought, oh my goodness, that is the most profound description of faith that I've ever heard apart from Scripture. Faith is simply acting like God is telling the truth. Do you notice it doesn't say faith is believing like God is telling the truth? Faith is acting like God is telling the truth, because with belief should come what?
Action.
Do you believe that today? Here's one of these opportunities. Do you believe that God is telling the truth today? Do you believe that the Word of God is true? Then we better know what it says. We better know what the truth is. In Hebrews chapter 11, we find something really pretty incredible, pretty amazing. The writer of Hebrews, knowing their audience is Jesus-believing Jews, takes them back into the lives of storied heroes of the Jewish faith. These snapshots of faith, if you will, give us an indication that these people that were reading and hearing these words knew these stories, and that they needed to be reminded of the faithfulness of God amidst their current oppression. You see, these people that the writer of Hebrews was writing to were being oppressed. And these snapshots of faith would then encourage these early believers to endure. Let's read it together. Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 to 10. If you've been in church at all in your life, then you've probably heard these words. And if you haven't, you probably heard some of these words too. Now, faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. By faith, Abel offered God a better sacrifice than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as a righteous man when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, he still speaks, even though he is dead. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. And our last snapshot. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he, Abraham, was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. Now, we could spend literally weeks breaking down these individual snapshots of faith, so I'm going to try to quickly break us down from Abel to Abraham. Notice each of these snapshots begins with the same two words. I want to hear you say them. These words are what? By faith. By faith. These are two words we should seek to live by each day if we want to live in today and for tomorrow. True legacy is living by faith each day, believing that God is telling the truth. All right, verse 4. By faith. We're not going to read every verse all the way through or every section all the way through. I'm just going to encapsulate. By faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain. This is not about who's better and worse. Too many times we look at this story and we think of, oh, well, Abel was so much better than Cain. Cain was such a bad person. You know, well, he ended up killing his brother. So, I mean, he wasn't a good person. But this isn't what this is about. It's not about who's better and worse. It's about Abel's best. That's the message. It wasn't a competition. It was a commitment. Abel said, I'm going to give you my best, God. And in Genesis 4, we learn that he actually offered shed blood instead of something his hands had prepared. That's commitment. It's sacrifice. What else does it say? It says that because of his offering, he was commended as righteous before God. Righteous. Someone who's in right standing before God. Do you want to be in right standing before God? I do. I don't want to have to shrink away from God for fear that I'm not enough. I can stand boldly before the throne of God because in Christ he has made me righteous by the shedding of his blood. And why was Abel righteous? Because Abel brought the Lord his best. Nothing less. And I think we can learn here that we need to bring our best each and every day. Full commitment to his plan, purpose for our life. You ever heard the old phrase, blood, sweat, and tears? Yeah, sometimes that's exactly what we need to offer God. Our best offerings, our best gifts, the best of ourselves to our work and to our worship. Are you offering your best to your work, but your less than best to your worship? Because God won't have any of that. It's two sides of the same coin. We must give our best. And remember, we're not in competition with our brothers and sisters in Christ. We are committed to bringing our best to the Lord. So that's our next statement that we need to fill in. If you've got a paper sheet, the second half isn't there. You can just fill it in. It's not a competition, it's a commitment. And it's not about who's better, it's about what's best. And guess what happens when we do that? Guess what happens when we aren't worried about competing with other believers? When we aren't worried about who's better? When all we're concerned about is my commitment to the Lord and giving him my best, legacy happens. Here are those two words again. At the end of verse 4, by faith, Abel still speaks, even though he is dead. Man, talk about a legacy. You want to continue to have your life speak beyond your death, long after your death? Then you and I, we've really got to make sure that what we're giving to God is worth speaking about. Because I don't know about you, but there are times when I feel like I don't have anything left to give. But then God, in his infinite love for me, fills me up with what I need to continue to endure, much like these people that were being written to. Verse 5, by faith, Enoch was taken straight to heaven so that he did not experience death. We're not going to read all of that. We already did. While alive, Enoch was commended as one who pleased God. Listen, Enoch wasn't some like superhuman. He wasn't like this like super over the top like abilities. He was like you and me. He was a sinful human being, just like you and just like me. He was not exempt from sin. Yet he was spoken of this way, as one who pleased God. Why? Say the two words. By faith. That's why. By faith. What do your contemporaries say about your life? I have to ask myself that question. What do my contemporaries say about my life? Do they talk about the good we do, or do they talk about the God we serve? So many of us are living our lives just trying to do good. And don't mishear me. Good is not bad. We want to do good. But what if good, what if there's more than just good? What if good isn't good enough? Over the years, teenagers like to ask this question, you know, like, Jeff, what makes Christians different from other people who just do good? It's that. It's not about the good we do. What's the difference between a mission trip and a Peace Corps? It's not about the good we do. It's about the God we serve. And that is the difference. You can go ahead and fill that one in. It's not about the good you do. It's about the God you serve. That's what we should be striving for. Verse 7, by faith, Noah built an ark. Okay, this one is big. Dare I say the biggest one in the list? They're all important, but why? Because Noah was operating in complete faith. Listen, I know most of us have heard the story of Noah hundreds and hundreds of times, but check this out. Noah had never seen rain. Like, if you actually read the scriptures, you learn, like, Noah had never actually seen it. He was operating in faith. God told him to build a giant boat because he was going to flood the earth with rain, which is water from the sky. He could in no way have comprehended the message of what God was going to bring about in the flood. Are there times that maybe God gives you a little nudge and you don't have any clue what he's really asking? But Noah took God seriously. So seriously, in fact, that some scholars believe he actually began planting trees so that he would make sure he had enough wood for the project. That's commitment. Other scholars believe he just got to work right away. Well, we know this to be true because Genesis 6:22, Noah did everything just as God commanded him. Whether he planted trees or just got started right away, the message is clear. Noah walked by faith. Not by sight. Noah was playing the long game. Did you know that there was a 120-year gap between God's command to build the ark and the actual flood? 120 years. How long have you been waiting for a promise from God? 120 years long? Not even close. But yet, if God doesn't give us what we think we deserve or what we think he's telling us today, then like me at the laundromat, I'm like, peace, I'm out, I give up. Sorry, God, you didn't come through. My question today is this: what kind of trees do you need to begin planting in your life right now? What seems like a long way off but needs your attention and action today? A tree of kindness toward that unkind coworker or neighbor? A tree of gentleness toward your spouse? A tree of patience? I need that one. A tree of patience with a teacher that's giving you a hard time? A tree of forgiveness toward that friend that hurt you? A tree of faith as you share the gospel with a lost friend or family member. But here's the thing. You don't just plant a tree and then it's fully grown the next day. Trees take time. What do you need to plant in your life today that God will show you his faithfulness of in the future. Or maybe not even show you. Show your children and your grandchildren and their children and their children. Did you know olive trees produce fruit for thousands of years? Talk about a tree of legacy. Maybe make a note underneath that about what action you plan to take today or this week. And then just see what God does. Also, don't you think that maybe Noah was probably mocked like crazy for what he was doing? Yeah. Sometimes God's word is going to say something that is contrary to popular opinion. Surprise! Sometimes it's going to say something that doesn't fit into your political party or the human constructs that we have placed to try to put God in a box. So who are we going to believe? Popular opinion of the world or the truth of the Lord? All right, last one. Abraham, by faith. Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. He up and left the comfort of his home for an unknown land. Would you do that? I actually did some research on the city of Ur, where the Bible tells us Abraham is from. And according to a team that did an archaeological dig in 2014, this is how they described it. A, quote, sprawling complex and great center of early civilization brimmed with trades and riches. That sounds pretty posh to me. That sounds comfortable. Abraham left that for the unknown. All because God said to, many of us would say, man, that is some risky faith. Can I let you in on a little secret? With God, when you don't take the risks, that's actually the most risky thing. Sometimes we have to step outside of what's comfortable, of what's playing it safe. So like Abraham, what comfort do you need to leave? What comfort do I need to leave? Maybe it's literally the comfort of your home. Maybe you and I need to get out and serve more. Maybe we need to step out of what is comfortable and start living the kind of life that builds legacy. Did you know that currently here at Woodland, we only have about 10% of the people doing 100% of the ministry? We need your gifts. We are not operating with a full suite of home appliances in God's house. Could you imagine what he would do if 100% left the comfort of their homes? Revival would break out across this community and beyond. If you're convicted about that, find a staff member after the service. We'd love to get you connected, and we'd love to help you find out what your spiritual gifts are. All right, a couple more fill in the blanks and then we need to close. How did Abraham do this though? He focused on the spiritual while looking for the physical. That is living in today, but for tomorrow. See guys, these aren't just stories. These aren't just stories to make us feel good about ourselves. This is the word of God, which is alive and useful for teaching and rebuking. Teaching us about who he is and his character, but also rebuking us in our sin. Hebrews 12:1, the very next chapter, says, let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. You know what my favorite word in that verse is, other than the name of Jesus, is author. Author indicates authority. The one who wrote the day that you are living in right now has given you his very own authority to win this day. Each day by faith. Through our faith in Christ, we are not only responsible, we are response-able. We are able to respond because we go as his messengers. He's given us everything we need. But we have to act. Faith and legacy are measured by the steps of one's feet, not by their feelings. Too many of us allow our feelings to dictate what we do today. Feelings should be the caboose. They don't get to drive the train. It's time to put our feelings back where they belong, under the authority, remember the author? Of the Creator. He drives the train. Do you want to do amazing things for God? Thank you. Do you want to do amazing things for God? Here's the thing. We get so caught up on what we can do for God, we forget what He can do through us. When we submit to God under the authority of God, then He's the one who does the amazing things through us. Quick analogy for closing. Most theme parks now, they have 3D rides and movies. When you walk into the ride vehicle theater, you receive a pair of glasses, right? If you try to watch the movie or experience the ride without the glasses, then you see a distorted picture. No matter how hard you strain or look or twist to try to make sense of what's happening, there is still a distortion because of the dimension through which you are looking. By handing you a pair of glasses when you walk in, they give you the tool you need to see the screen without distortions. Now, this actually just happened with Liam a few weeks ago. Liam's our four-year-old. You knew you weren't going to get out of here without a quick Liam story. Where he's four. He's one of a kind in so many ways. Anyway, Liam refused to wear the 3D glasses on the Lego Ninjago ride because he was too scared. Like the loving father that I am, and not in a very patient way, I tried to tell him everything was safe and he didn't need to be afraid. That I was right there with him. But he's four. And he knows everything. So he didn't want to hear it. To him, my words of reassurance to him were not enough. He was too scared. He refused. His feelings were driving his train. He was not submitting under the authority of the Father telling him, it's going to be okay. And because of that fear, he didn't get the full experience. Only a distorted one. One of the problems that many of us in the church today and in the Christian world today is that we have a distorted view. If I'm just going to be honest with myself, our vision is not clear because we're too afraid to use the tools God has given us to walk by faith in each day. Even though He's speaking to us as a loving Father saying, it's okay, I'm faithful, we're still too afraid. So we don't put on our spiritual glasses. We see what we see, but we do not see all there is to be seen. If all you see is the physical, a visible scenario, then you're looking at the situation without your glasses. We need to have a divine frame of reference in order to see what is really going on if we want to live for today, to create a legacy for tomorrow. So church, let's put on our divine glasses. Let's not be afraid to use what God has given to us so that we can start walking, what are the two words? By faith. Because God, in His goodness, wasn't just faithful then. He's faithful now. Let's pray. God, You are so good. You remind us in Your word that even when we have fear, even when we have feelings of inadequacy, by faith, we can win today. And not for ourselves, but for Your glory. So Lord, as we go from this place, Lord, please just give us a sense of what You see. Help us to see our day the way that You would have us to see it. Because apart from you, we can do nothing. But with you, all things are possible. In Jesus' name.